They're here dressed for combat or partially dressed as two teams pursue perfection.
Both teams 6-0.
Start thinking about winning right now!
It's all about who wants to be 7-0.
5, 6, 7!
It's all about survival.
Football's premier pregame show.
Out of the thin mountain air, out of the wild blue yonder, an unlikely meeting of unbeaten, both flying high into the season's second half. Welcome to the U.S. Air Force Academy. Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, Kirk Herbstreit. Guys, it's great to be home. I've seen a lot of games in this stadium behind me here. Nothing approaching this. Last year we were here as kind of a tribute to a military academy football. Today we're here because this is the day's biggest game.
You look at Air Force and you look at Notre Dame. Both these teams are doing the little things. They're so well coached. You could probably find teams that have better individual talent, but I'm telling you right now, it's the reason these teams are unbeaten is because they're taking advantage of their opponent's mistakes and they're not making mistakes of their own. Both teams are plus 10 in the turnover margin, and that's a big factor tonight. Who will be able to capitalize on their opponent's mistake will probably win this game.
Well, Kirk, as of now, as you know, you and I have both seen all the top 10 teams in the nation live and in color, with the exception of Oregon and North Carolina State. I'm anxious to see how this Notre Dame team stacks up to those other great football teams we've seen. I think they're in the top five when it comes to character. I want to see how they rank, if in the top five football-wise.
And tonight will tell.
Absolutely,
mind.
I think so.
Well, we start the second semester of the season with still 10 teams in 1A unbeaten. That's about double the number I thought we had. You can make an entire bowling pin lineup with easy 7-10 split is kind of tough. Let's talk about Bowling Green coming up. But of course, Oklahoma and Virginia Tech trailing in the polls anyway. Number one, Miami. Storylines today, we start with the nation's most dynamic player facing the nation's most punishing second half schedule. If Cyclone Seneca Wallace can guide his guys through this gauntlet, he can strike the pose. But the Sooners say they got too much pride and speed and too much at stake to let it happen. Is the combustible Maurice Claret pointing to the pros already? And is all the noise a distraction and more motivation for Wisconsin today? And how is a program actually holding open tryouts on campus, unbeaten and unranked? And ranked, they say? We'll meet Urban Meyer's Bowling Green Falcons. They are quite a story. Of course, a reminder here that Ohio State could meet Air Force in the Fiesta Bowl tonight. Under the lights, under perhaps a record crowd right here, one of the most meaningful games in Academy history and the last collision of unbeatens this regular season unless Miami and Virginia Tech survive until December. These are teams that combined for 11 wins last year. They also suffered off-the-field embarrassments, but they've responded, they've rebounded, they represent the two most pleasant surprises of the season so far. Tonight, one side's dream season continues, the other is derailed. And that David Goliath perception, you know, Notre Dame Blue Bloods, Academy Overachievers, shattered just a bit because Air Force comes in favored off 100 points and no turnovers in the last two games.
They definitely run the option to perfection. You know, they do what they do very well.
Their players have the confidence to play at a speed that no one can duplicate.
We're not going to show them the same look the entire game.
This is not a style of offense that you can freelance against. Anytime they run the option, you have to be the soundest that you've been.
Growing up, it's what you dream of, watching college football. You know, you just dream about being, you know, on national TV in front of everybody playing a big-time game, so it's pretty exciting.
You're not human unless you think Notre Dame is a special game, and I mean, I just can't wait to go and play and, you know, see those gold helmets. And but the thing is, we're not going to let the mystique get to us.
The preseason magazines, the rate 1-117, had the Irish between 31 and 41. The Falcons were picked in the bottom third of 1A. They got 0 points in the preseason polls. You can't really blame anyone for doubting either side. Neither side really is thumping on their chest saying, what do you think now? What do you think now, everybody? That's refreshing in this day and age, believe me. When you play Air Force, the Falcons say in the eyes of the opponents, each game, they have seen the will and the desire drain as the game goes on. I don't know about Notre Dame, yeah. But what makes it tough to prepare for them?
Well, from a coach's standpoint, when you get ready for an Air Force-type offense, you modify your base defense. You don't make wholesale changes because that hurts you more than it helps you. First of all, you start with the defensive line. They've got to crowd the ball and keep the offensive linemen off the linebackers because the linebackers flow from the inside out is the top, best way to stop the option. Number two, you bring your free safety and strong safety up to the box to stop the run. But that causes a problem because the counter play and the play action series will then kill you with big plays. And Kirk, the most important part about this thing, you can't practice against it. So mark it on your calendar. Watch the Air Force Academy. Early in the game, they're going to drive down and score, and then after that, the Irish will adjust.
You know, that was very nice. It's very easy to write down how to defend this option, but I'm telling you, it is tough. The one thing that I think helps Notre Dame is they're tired of hearing about this Air Force option. For 7 days, they've been hearing about this triple option attack and chance errors. Well, today we're going to find out how good the Falcons really are on offense because they're going up against the Notre Dame defense. It's one of the best in the country. They're only allowing 76 yards a game on the ground. A big reason for that has been the play of their linebackers. Courtney Watson is one of the better players on the defense. He'll be in the middle. He'll be very active and making a lot of plays. Mike Goolsby also, blue-collar guy who's up always making plays. Now, Chance Herridge has not been stopped yet. And I think that's the key in this game. Notre Dame is going to try to take Herridge out of the game. How will Herridge respond to the first time that he's been taken out of the game? Is he willing to get the fullback and the play-action pass involved? We'll tell you if Air Force can show that they have enough diversity in this offense to beat Notre Dame.
Not knock him out of the game, just take him out of the game plan.
Knock him out of the game.
Plenty more in this game coming up. We're going to meet Chance Herridge, that quarterback who does walk that fine line between military poise and talking too much noise. Also, plenty more in that excellent Notre Dame defense that's committed to stop him. And we'll meet the sophomore captain at Air Force. That is a history-making position for Anthony Schlegel. Meanwhile, the Sooners brought back from Dallas the Golden Stetson. Now the challenge, put a whole bunch of hats on Seneca Wallace and the Cyclones, who've scored 30-plus in all 7 games. Now, Iowa State hasn't been 3-0 in the conference since 1949. They have never beaten a top-five team, 0-48-2. But then they've never had a weapon like Seneca Wallace, who later on we're going to feature the most exciting 12-yard runner in history. He has been so good on third down, a 69% passer who averages 17 yards of completion. And yes, the Sooners have been troubled a bit by quarterbacks with similar slipperiness to Seneca.
Best playmaker in college football. This guy just doesn't run. He does it all.
He's the heart of their team.
We just have to be great tacklers.
Number one guy, number 15.
What impresses me the most about him is the way he throws the ball. He doesn't get as much credit as he should for the way he throws it. Real accurate on the run.
Seneca Wallace has just poise about, he's confident in his scrambling ability. And we had problems with that against Missouri, but now that we've seen that with Brad Smith, our team should be comfortable with a quarterback that can do things like that.
Super Seneca races in.
When you get the opportunities to make tackles, to make plays, to contain them, you have to be disciplined and you've got to be able to make plays against them.
He'll be like the next Doug Flutie or something like that in the league. He'll carry any team, I believe, that he plays for.
At 5'10", he's only an inch taller than Flutie. Guys who've created havoc for OU, all in Sooner wins, by the way. Common trait, ability to make plays with their feet, Brad Smith a couple weeks ago. Wallace can do that, of course, but this year he has been scrambling a little bit less, throwing more and better. Now, OU's defenders are coaches that got a lot of pride in the football team. They said they're ready for that challenge.
Well, Oklahoma's team is eighth in the nation in scoring defense, and they get stronger as the game goes along. Last week against Texas, they allowed the Longhorns 68 yards of total offense in the entire second half. The key performer, number 10, Lance Mitchell. Now, I want you to watch Lance's football position as he gets ready to stick Sims. He rarely misses a tackle. He will be assigned to Mr. Wallace today. Now, remember one thing about that stat we showed you. Those three mobile quarterbacks, yes, they got some yardage. But you know what, Kirk? Your Oklahoma team beat all three of those guys. Oklahoma finds a way to win.
Like I say, you're coming around.
I know.
I'm starting to see the light with Oklahoma. Big part of Iowa State's identity nationally, of course, is the play of the quarterback, Seneca Wallace. But there's a lot more to this team. Trust me, they're incredibly athletic on defense. And I think today against Quentin Griffin, they're going to attack the line of scrimmage with their safeties and their linebackers, try to get Oklahoma in obvious passing downs, and then come after him with a lot of pressure. And they have people who can run. The guy to watch is number one, defensive end Tyson Smith, 5 tackles for a loss here. He fights through Brett Williams, comes up with one of his 3 sacks on the year. Now, if Oklahoma cannot establish the run with Quentin Griffin, which they were able to do last week, and Nate Hibble has to make plays by throwing, Iowa State has the athletic ability to make it a long day for Nate Hibble, because they are athletic and they will come after him with a lot of blitzes. So Oklahoma better have that running game going.
And I'm not sure Hibble can be that confident coming in against Iowa State off the 4 picks against Texas. 70% chance of thunderstorms in Norman. Ooh. That's really the only big ball game around the country that has a weather issue. There is no weather issue here tonight. The forecast is for clear skies, pretty mild temperatures, and a great scene, a great turnout. We will forecast the BCS. The first official numbers come out on Monday. We'll talk about, speaking of Texas, Chris Sims. How much confidence can he have going into Kansas State? And Rex Grossman. His many gifts apparently also include understatement.
They're going to be judged by their first year a lot, and you know, we're in a slump right now, but in no way do I think we're out of a lot of our goals.
Today's show presented by Discover Card. Want to appear on Gameday this New Year's Day? Visit discovercard.com for details. And in part by Marriott. Wherever business takes you, your Marriott awaits.
A tremendous crowd here tonight. Big crowd at LSU. Tigers got to handle prosperity after smacking the Gators and win with a young fill-in quarterback. Colts' Gamecocks cannot afford a second SEC loss. Jeff Hollinger and Todd Christensen check in now from Baton Rouge.
The late Bear Bryant said of Tiger Stadium, "This happens to be the worst place in the world for a visiting team. It's like being inside a drum." And in 2002, the beat goes on.
Certainly for the LSU Tigers, who were able to exorcise some of their own demons last week in the swamp by shellacking Florida. But the game came at a cost. They lost starting quarterback Matt Mauk, and he is going to be replaced by Marcus Randall, complete with the entire playbook there on his left wrist. It will be no easy task, despite the fact that he is at home. He is going against Lou Holtz and the South Carolina Gamecocks, who have their own streak going, having won 4 straight coming into Death Valley.
This will be the biggest crowd South Carolina will see this season. 91,600, all shouting LSU.
LSU! LSU!
And they'll have lots of time to get prepared. Good thing with a new young quarterback coming in there that he's at home. What about Randall, though?
Also, Marcus Randall's offense will not change with LSU's offense. Excuse me. And what they'll do is they're going to run him 75% of the time, Kirk, on predetermined plays like the old single wing. I think LSU wins with defense, and Marcus Randall doing a great job.
Yeah, and Randall making his first start. How nice is it to have the number one defense in the country? And I'm telling you guys, you look at this LSU defense, I think they might be better than the SEC's best defense and the team that won the SEC championship last year. This, and especially in the secondary, they're going to win today with defense.
Winning close games. They won 5 straight by a touchdown or less after they lost 10 in a row by that margin. Les la bon temps roulé for now in Baton Rouge. Next week at Auburn. Tonight, the Tigers in the once feared but no more swamp, and in the once deafening stadium, the Gators' offense has been stinking out loud. They'll get 0 sympathy from the Auburn defense, which is really banged up, especially up front. And they got run over in their home stadium by Arkansas last week. A rude reality check for a Tiger team that had been feasting on victims who are combined 1-15 against 1A competition this year. Tony Barnett is on the scene in Gainesville, which is not yet a sellout, and that is big news. A couple of teams, Tony, that enter this game wounded, but I got to believe the Gators' wounds seem a little bit more serious. Good morning.
Good morning, Chris. You know, you're exactly right. You know, when Florida beat Tennessee back on September 21st, that bought a lot of goodwill for Ron Zook and this new coaching staff. But after consecutive losses to Ole Miss and LSU, the Gators are out of the AP Top 25 for the first time in 209 weeks. And I can tell you guys, down here in the swamp, some of the Gators are starting to get very nasty.
I don't know what I'd tell them, but they have a right to be upset if they want to be. At the same time, they've been spoiled for, you know, the past how many years, and, you know, teams are all equal these days.
We're 20, 21, 22-year-old young men, and we're not perfect. We're going to make mistakes. You know, Rex Grossman can't go out there and throw for 400 yards and six touchdowns every game.
With only one touchdown in the last six quarters and eight interceptions in the past two games, Grossman is taking the heat for a new offensive system the Gators have yet to grasp.
It's not too complex. It just, it's not being run efficiently. A lot of the things, you know, like I said, we need to just make first downs and not try to hit the big home run. And, you know, we're striking out.
There is a lot of concern. There's a lot of support. You know, it's important to people, and you know, and our players understand that it's important. And you know, maybe sometimes you know we all try to press too much and to please, but you know, we're going to be fine.
Guys, and let me update you on a couple of injuries. Grossman missed some practice this week with a sprained knee. He's going to be fine, may wear a brace. Not so for Todd Johnson. Missed a ton of practice with a deep thigh bruise. It's going to be a game-time decision on him. Now, Coach, you always talk about teams need to play with urgency and redemption. I'm telling you, if the Gators are going to salvage this season, they have got to get it done tonight.
You and ours tough, Tony, I'm telling you. But I think no matter what his final record is after the first year, Ron Zook will return as the coach of the Gators, and I don't think he'll make a single change in his staff because I think they're good enough to win in Florida. Now, Ron's major problem besides losing is the fact he doesn't have a head coaching record to fall back on. I know from a personal experience, I was not successful at Indiana right away. I got criticized, but the people looked at my Louisville record, and they let me stay, and I lasted 10 years. That's his problem. He's got nowhere to look that he's done it before, and that's why they're all anxious.
And people are starting to hit the panic button here. Yeah. You look at Rex Grossman, four interceptions last week, four interceptions the week before that. The offensive line can't protect him, and now you have Ron Zook contemplating sitting Rex Grossman for the next few football games. The fact that he's even bringing that up, here is a coach, a first-year head coach, he's on the ropes, and he's even bringing up the fact that he may sit Rex Grossman, tells me that there's some personal issues behind the scenes with Grossman and Ron Zook, and I think it has a lot to do with the fact that Grossman has made checks to last year's Spurrier's fun and gun offense, and he's thrown interceptions off of that, and they're saying if you're going to continue to do that, we're going to sit you down. Because of all that, run the football today against Auburn. Auburn gave up over 400 yards rushing to Arkansas. Florida will run today, and they will get a must-need win today. They got to turn this thing around.
You say, well, don't check to the old offense. That's a bad idea.
No, not a good idea.
And practice, even. I mean, you just don't want to.
Not going over well.
No.
And plus, the other guys don't know what he's doing. In the SEC West, Ole Miss brings a share of the lead in Tuscaloosa, where they are 1-18 all time. Only their second road game, when they flopped in Lubbock the first time. They have a brutal stretch of their schedule that's going to really define this Ole Miss team. At Alabama, the quarterback situation, Watts is healthy. The fans still want to see Brody Croyle, which is an interesting issue for Franchione there.
Well, I don't think the quarterback issue is going to matter here for Alabama. They've got to be able to get the football into the hands of their running backs. Eddie Strong is back now for Ole Miss. They've played much better the last 2 weeks, but it really comes down to the ability of Alabama to find ways to get the football in the hands of Shad Williams. Since he's been able to step up from Ahmad Galloway, I think Shad Williams has become their best player on offense. You can run the football with him. They try to find him the ball in space as far as catching the ball out of the backfield. And when he needs a rest, Ray Hudson can come in and spell him along with Santonio Beard. The backfield is the key for Alabama. And after the heartbreak loss to Georgia, this Alabama team is just anxious to get back out on the football field again. It's going to be a test today against Ole Miss and Eli Manning. But I think the defense and I think the play of Shad Williams will be the difference. I like Alabama.
Well, that's a good pick.
All right.
You know, and Alabama Alabama had that week off, and during the week off, they worked very hard on their pass rush and some new coverages. Why? Because Ole Miss's run offense is average at best, and Eli Manning, the quarterback, can beat them. So they worked very, very hard with the defensive backs jumping to the ball. Charlie Peppra, number 26 here, will show you exactly what they need to do. He makes the play, takes it away, all the way, touchdown, Roll Tide. Now, the Tide staffed and also did a very good job of resting their football team, because this is an interesting stat. In the last six ball games they've lost, Alabama and five of those have been outscored 55-3 in the last 7 minutes of the game. That's amazing. That's a blue liner. But today,
they
Roll Tide will win.
You mentioned Pepper. You were telling me his grandfather used to be the president of Ghana.
That's right. That's what he told me.
Did you pick him to win the election? Did you?
No. With my picks, he better not have me pick him.
Georgia, meanwhile, they don't want to blow their perfect season so far against Vanderbilt. Moussa Smith, he's got a hyperextended neck. He's expected to play. DJ Shockley comes back. He's available. So Mark Richt in that quarterback situation is something to keep an eye on there.
Keep an eye on it.
We'll talk about the BCS coming up. The standings about to come out. Old Miami or Virginia Tech be number one. And we'll talk about the other Falcons team that's unbeaten and has a great running quarterback. A little primer course coming up.
A lot of times when you talk to people, some people don't even know the Bowling Green is in the MAC. Other people don't even know what the MAC is.
Welcome back to Air Force. A reminder, Michigan-Purdue follows us at noon Eastern. We'll hit on that game as well. And, of course, this game in prime time, 10 o'clock Eastern, 8 o'clock Mountain Time. Now, the final unbeaten team to push into the polls is Bowling Green, ranked for the first time in 17 years under the second-year turnaround artist Urban Meyer, who stunned us when he labeled the Falcons a good team from a bad program. Huh? Now, what he's talking about is this team has zero depth. They're decimated by injuries. They got freshmen all over the two deep today. They're so banged up, they have open tryouts on campus to find able bodies. That's unusual for a ranked team. They do have, however, one of the most dangerous run-pass quarterbacks in the country. Josh Harris, number one in points responsible for, a big 230-pounder who can really take a hit, and he runs it 15 to 25 times a game. Here's Curry Kirkpatrick with more on the little program making an unusual name for itself and a famous new fan.
Let's play name association. Bowling.
I am PDW, and I am bowling. Yeah, you like it?
Green. Bowling Green.
A lot of people say, isn't that in Kentucky?
When you talk to someone that isn't familiar with the place, they come, Bowling Green? What is a Bowling Green?
Bowling Green? Every bowler loves Bowling Green.
To us, Bowling Green means football.
And this year, Bowling Green means winning football. The undefeated Falcons have absolutely bowled over bigger name teams such as Missouri and Kansas while striking for an NCAA leading 50 points a game and sparing no opponent's feelings.
We may not be a Big Ten or SEC or, you know, Pac-10 school, but we know there's some pretty good football players around here.
When you play bigger schools, do you use that as motivation?
Absolutely. We use everything we possibly can find for motivation. And we're 5-0 against BCS conference teams, and we've used that every time.
Okay, but name association time again. Urban? Urban Meyer?
When I was at Notre Dame, Coach Holt forgot my name, and I somehow associated with Urban Cowboy. And just started screaming, "Hey, Cowboy." I mean, for 5 minutes, I finally turned around, and it was Coach trying to get my attention, so that kind of nickname stuck with me for a little while.
There's another name quandary here. You'd think the colors of Bowling Green would be like green, right? Wrong. They're brown and orange. These guys might as well be bowlers.
Do you bowl at all?
No, sir.
Not very often. We don't get very much time to bowl.
No, I can't say that I've been bowling in Bowling Green yet.
They're not bowling at Bowling Green?
We pretty much find other things to do with our time.
All us bowlers still love Bowling Green.
That's a great fan to have. I'd like to see him with those same antics on the lanes up in our stands watching one of our games, jumping and cheering around.
You gotta get him some tickets.
I'm pretty sure that could be arranged.
At least for games on campus, which happens to be in Ohio. Still, anonymity remains as familiar to Bowling Green as an old bowling shoe.
Well, does it bother me? No, no. I tell you what, the ranked 23rd in that coach's poll probably means more to me and our staff and our players than anything.
We don't want to be in the top 25 for just for 1 week just to say we were there. We want to keep going and being successful so that we can hopefully keep moving up.
Go Falcons.
They don't need a perfect game today. Yeah. They don't need to score 300 points. They're going to need to outscore Western Michigan with all those freshmen on defense, I think.
Bowling Green gets one more point than Western Michigan and wins and stays undefeated.
Is Pete Weber a wrestler or a bowler? I didn't get
whatever
the,
you want, sweetheart.
With the annex
whatever
and
you
the
want.
Glass.
Whatever
yeah,
you
he's
want.
Fired up there, isn't he?
Western gives
he's
the game today.
Ric Flair signs.
Yeah, right.
No, I think Bowling Green wins.
Western will give him a good game. They've been well, in against was, Virginia yeah. Tech and
we'll
Michigan
see.
And
we'll
Purdue.
See how many we'll points. See. Harris will do it.
Win or lose today, you're not going to see Bowling Green in the first official BCS numbers revealed Monday on SportsCenter. Air Force right now, unofficially, down there at 13. You see Virginia Tech today would be ahead of Miami, but Miami may leapfrog them because being idle is better than playing Rutgers as far as your schedule strength. Notre Dame, you see, because of the strength of the computers, is ranked up there pretty high. In fact, on four of the computers that they factor in, they rank one or two. That's well ahead of Miami, which is being hurt by having Florida A&M on there. Now, you see the impact right there, Lee, of removing margin of victory. You and I have agreed on very little in the first 4 years of the BCS. You're a company guy.
Yeah, I know.
I'm
okay.
A doubter. But we do agree on this change this year. Bad idea.
Well, Chris, you know, when I was a football coach, I always thought the margin of victory was a good barometer for me to test my ability against my competition. And I think the BCS made a mistake taking the margin of victory out. I think they should have capped it at 21. Now, without the margin of victory, Notre Dame and most of the computers is ahead of Miami as a better all-around football team.
Yo, I knew the yo was
no
coming.
No way.
Well, you imagine an offense ranked 113th in the nation being ahead of Miami in the computers. Forget about the computers are so volatile, it's tough to figure them out. You think about last year at this time, everybody started the what-if scenario. What if more than two teams are undefeated at the end of the year? Last year, when the first BCS standings came out, we had eight undefeated teams, and at the end of the year, we had one. It'll work itself out. And the other thing is, I think the big factor today and this year in college football will be the quality win component. The last couple years, it's come down to decimal points, and if you can get wins against quality teams, that's going to get you over the hump if there's more than one or two teams deserving.
Work itself out. You promise? It didn't
yes,
work,
no.
didn't work
well,
itself out last year.
No,
right?
Well, it actually...
It was
we'll
a mess. It was a mess.
Talk about that later.
Let's look at the road ahead for these unbeaten teams and the schedule strength based on opponent winning percentage. Oregon has the toughest. There's no free passes in the Pac-10. Virginia Tech, according to this, they have the easiest road opponents winning percentage, but they probably have the single toughest game of anybody at Miami. I'm telling you, this may not work itself out. You may have some teams unbeaten.
We could be, but I think Virginia Tech has the best chance of running the table and getting that title game the way it looks right now, and I'll tell you why. Because they have the type of football team. They run the football. They play solid defense. They kick the ball very well. You win at home and on the road like that, even at Miami. Now, here's something that's really screwy. If number one Miami plays number two Virginia Tech, the loser of that game could end up getting a rematch in Tempe. I know. It's possible.
All right, War and Peace here. Let me get in real quick here. Too much focus, I think, by all of us as fans on the big games, the big upsets. Let's see who has the toughest schedule remaining. Don't forget last year, in just the final few weeks, it was the upsets, the games you didn't really expect, really determined who got into the national championship game. So while we're all looking at who has the tough games, I think upsets will turn this BCS upside down before it's all said and done.
Now, that I do agree with you on.
All right.
We'll stand by for future weeks for those upsets. Now, the Falcon is here, real and imagined, so are plenty of their fans. And we'll break down the Fighting Irish and the Falcons coming up. Also, the story in the Pac-10 today. Speaking of upsets and speaking of teams that can't afford a loss, and can Ohio State afford to have this talk continue about Maurice Claret one and done to the pros? That story ahead.
College Game Day is presented by Discover Card, proud sponsor of college football's premier pregame show.
There's the Cadet Show Choir. We thank them for showing up. It's tough to get the vocal cords warmed up in a cold morning. And what's coaching Air Force today, a famous uncle to the Falcon kicker, Joey Ashcroft, made 7 of 8 this season, nephew of John Ashcroft.
When we get together on Thanksgiving or a holiday, it's usually football and what the family's doing. Not usually a political talk.
Criminal justice arsenal to acquire.
So the attorney general looking in you, Joey, a very good kicker. He's made 7 of 8 this season. Your guy Seta on the other side, kickers today, maybe?
Very, very good. Nick Seta could be the difference in this football game tonight.
Ashcroft has never in his life made a game-winning kick, high school or college. Says he's always dreamt of it. Blocked field goals have been big in the history of this series historically. When you talk quarterbacks, though, you got to talk about the Pac-10 conference. You see right here, 6 of the top 15 in passing efficiency from one conference. Combined, they have 7 400-yard games. That equals the all-time high, 2 each by Walter and Jason Johnson. You know, Carson Palmer is actually last in passing efficiency among Pac-10 starters, and he's a 60% passer with only 6 picks in 6 games. It shows you how good the passing has been in that conference. At the Coliseum, Washington's first road game in 48 days since the gut-wrenching loss at Michigan. Neither side can afford a second conference loss this early. The Huskies searching in vain for that running game. They face a Trojan defense that is really banged up. Troy Polamalu still not 100%. Something for Pickett and Reggie Williams to keep in mind today.
It is. 2 weeks ago, we talked about USC's defense. They were the number one defense in the country. Couple injuries later, they've given up 536 passing yards in the last couple games, and now they're facing the best passing offense in the Pac-10, one of the best in the country in the Washington Huskies. Cody Pickett has had a phenomenal year, and of course, his favorite target is Reggie Williams. He's been able to come up with a lot of big catches, 184 yards last week, 3 touchdown catches. Big guy, 6'4", 220 pounds. And I think Pickett and Williams, they're going to score a lot of points, but Washington has one of the worst pass defenses in the Pac-10. So Carson Palmer also would have put up a lot of points, a lot of scoring, and I think it comes down to Washington. John Anderson, the field goal kicker, will win it for Washington in a high-scoring game.
Nice pick. Nice pick. Well, Thanks. You just used all my stuff. Washington is last in the Pac-10 on pass defense, so watch my man Carson Palmer light it up in L.A. Now, Carson, number 3, as you see right here, well, has a quick release, and he throws to Mike Williams for a touchdown right there. Now, one of the hidden stats that makes USC tough to beat is the fact that they're number 1 team in the nation in time of possession. So with that fact, and not so fast, my friend, I got you. West Coast style. USC beats his Washington team at L.A.
Have you mentioned Washington's last in the Pac-10 in pass defense? Other games in the conference. Oregon begins a 4-game and 5-game home stretch here. They don't want to overlook high-scoring Arizona State. Dirk Cutter, the former Duck assistant right there. ASU, number 1 in the sacks.
Well, they put a lot of pressure on you. But they also, you know, this is one of these things where I think their only chance is to score with Oregon. I think Oregon playing at home. Keenan Howery's healthy. This offense is really starting to click. I like Oregon scoring too many points.
I agree with it.
Meanwhile, UCLA and Bob Toledo really starting to take some heat. They're glad to be on the road today with their 3-0 against Cal.
Yeah, but Corey Paulus can throw the football. He scores, and watch it. It's a surprise team of the nation in November is going to be UCLA.
They're coming back.
Absolutely.
All right. We'll coming up next, we'll talk about the fallout of the Red River flop for Texas and Chris Sims.
I don't give a damn about my legacy. I really don't. The only thing I care about in this world is our team and winning ball games.
This quarterback has been willing ball games. We'll talk about Air Force quarterback Chance Herridge, and later, the Notre Dame defense today dedicated to stopping him. That's more on College Game Day from the Air Force Academy.
Tradition, brought to you by the Tostitos Tournament of Champions, the 1972 USC Trojans, or the 1986 Penn State Nittany Lions. Who's the best ever? Vote on ESPN.com, and you could win a trip to the Tostitos Fiesta Bowl.
Hey, about lunch for a few thousand. One of the great traditions here, all the cadets of the Air Force Academy eat lunch together. On Game Day Q&A, we asked players around the country which of the 3 main service academies would you prefer to attend?
Oh, man. See, if I was in the Army, I'd run, and I hate planes, so I'd have to choose it. Well, I'm scared of water, too.
I would probably say I'd probably go to Air Force. Reason being, maybe because, I like that their offense is pretty, you know, neat, like wing tee and all types of stuff, running the option and stuff like that, so it would be an exciting game.
It wouldn't be Air Force, because I don't like to fly. It'd probably be the Navy. My dad was in the Navy, so I mean, I think everybody has respect for all three of those schools and everybody on those teams. So.
I'd have to go Army because, you know, I don't know, I'm on land, and if something, I could go hide somewhere too, but I'm not a chicken, but I can go hide.
Yeah, guys that don't like to fly, don't like the water, choose Army. Your choice is pretty easy.
Oh, right? Very easy. I was an assistant football coach at the United States Naval Academy. They got me my first job at the University of Louisville, so they'll always be my favorite. Go Navy!
I'm with Seneca Wallace. Run the triple option. That's the great thing about Air Force. Besides the jets, the triple option with Fisher DeBerry.
Lee, you got a boot here today.
Go Navy!
You know, the latest feisty, scrappy, southern, less than 100% military spit and polish option quarterback to choose Air Force is the junior out of Bonaire, Georgia, named Chance Harridge. Now, six opponents have not been able to corral him yet. He's run for 15 touchdowns, but we captured him for an hour this week.
Who is Chance Harridge?
Chance is just a nut.
Probably Fireball would be about the way you describe him.
Best thing I'd say about him is he's a winner.
He's a real deal.
That's me. I have the heart of a lion, I believe. I never say die type attitude. I am a leader.
We are more physical than they are.
The most rewarding thing about playing football is having 10 other guys in a huddle looking at you and having complete confidence in what you say and what you bring to the table. Everything that I do comes from within. It's a passion for the game. I am Chance Harridge. Actually, my first name is Joseph, and then Chance is my middle name. I got that name from an old Western by John Wayne. My parents said that, you know, hey, one day they'd name one of their kids after that character whose name was Chance. I'm very passionate about my family. My folks moved out here just to see the entire football season. They even show up to practice, too. They don't really know a whole lot about football, but just having them there and able to talk with them, it makes life a lot easier, especially around here at the Academy.
I am a cadet at the United States Air Force Academy.
I want to be a fighter pilot. That's every kid's dream. I don't see anything in the world that could be any more exciting than not only serving your country, but then flying jets at the same time. I've never been in a jet before. Never. And I can't wait. That's who I am.
And his coaches told us last night those same traits that make him a good quarterback are going to help him be a good fighter pilot. You know, 15 rushing touchdowns leads the nation, Kirk. He got accused in an ESPN.com chat of being selfish because no back has more than two, and they've combined for 10. But he says, I'm not selfish. They have just not eliminated him yet. No opponent has from the option.
It's been the reads, and he's taken advantage of it. With all the strategies in college football over the years, the way the game continues to evolve, the one thing you can count on is the triple option attack here at Air Force. And you have to have a quarterback who's not only athletic, he's smart, makes good decisions, but he's also very consistent with his reads. Now, the triple option is a complex scheme. I'm going to show you what it takes. There's a couple reads there. The front man is your dive read. The back guy is the pitch. Watch the dive read. What he does determines what Chance Harridge will do. Here he commits down to the fullback. By taking the fullback, that tells the quarterback to pull the ball and take it to the next level, to the pitch read, the outside linebacker. It all happens very fast. Air Force makes it look easy. And there's a 15-yard gain. Now, the toughest thing for a defense in preparing for this triple option is you get so consumed for 7 days in defending the run, defending the triple option, that's when you have to look out for the play action. Last week against BYU, they got caught up in Chance Harridge in defending the run, and that's when the safety fell asleep. He forgot about the assignment football, play action off the option. Watch the safety. He's committed. He's looking at the run. By the time he realizes that Harridge is off and throwing, he's got to get back into his zone, and the post is going to go behind him. Watch that safety full speed. And by the way, notice the throw there by Chance Harridge. That's the challenge tonight for Notre Dame. Not only the triple option and getting so caught up with defending the run, they've got to be able to show the discipline to stay back and also defend the play action pass.
Tough to do.
And later on, Mike Golick will join us. We'll talk about defending that option and the Notre Dame defensive guys who have put a target on Chance Harridge tonight. Speaking of quarterbacks who are always targeted, Chris Sims and Texas. They are just removed from a third straight bullying by Oklahoma. Now they trudge off to Kansas State. Longhorns are still the highest-ranked once-beaten team, and they still have some of their major goals intact. The Wildcats also cannot afford a second conference loss this early. But what about Texas? After consecutive offensive flops, and now some players kind of grumbling about the game plan, just how confident can Chris Sims still be? Chris Sims goes back to pass, scrambles left. He goes down, he's sacked, and the game is over.
I was devastated that we lost, you know, and the thing is we were in control of the game for the most part, and to let it slip away there really in the fourth quarter, it hurts. I don't really listen to anything, really. I kind of just go about my life, you know. I go to class and do the same things I do in a normal week. I don't really care what people say about me on TV or in the newspaper. And, you know, I got a job to do, and I'm just going to continue to do it.
Well, the good news for Sims, K-State not ranked in the top 10. Those are the teams that he's had real trouble against. But they are a team that puts pressure on the quarterback to beat him. Do you still believe in Sims in games like this?
Well, let me tell you, I've seen Chris Sims three times live and in color, the Holiday Bowl and two Oklahoma games. And I think Chris Sims is a good college quarterback, not a great one. And I don't think Chris Sims is good enough to beat top-ranked football teams by himself. I do think Grossman, Wallace, Dorsey, and Leftwich could do it, but not Sims. Good quarterback, not a great one.
The question is not can Chris Sims win the big game, it's can Texas win the big game. Look at last week. Nate Hibble threw four interceptions, and Oklahoma won 35-24. You're telling me if you put Sims in an Oklahoma jersey, the Sooners don't win, and that was considered a big game? Texas needs to start playing with a little bit more of an attitude in big games. Santana Moss said it when he was at Miami. Big-time players make big plays in big games, and that's what's missing at Texas. They need to step up as a team and make those big plays, and the coaches need to quit coaching not to lose and play to win. That's what's happened to them in these big games.
Amen. You were talking about big plays.
Yeah.
On the Kansas State defensive side, that's been kind of a problem, to say the least.
Yeah. Well, no question about that. Kansas State, though, is still ranked number four in scoring offense. Now, they got torched by Colorado, but two new starters in the secondary change their coverages, blitz more, and now they look like the old Kansas State defensive football team. Watch number 18, Brian Hickman. He got really good hands as he drops in and makes a good defensive play. Now, they'll also pressure the quarterback and also come from behind, and I'm telling you, they're going to be all over Chris Sims with players like he comes in from the outside. Now, if you understand this, Kansas State has won eight games in a row, so they can beat Texas, no question in my mind. And you know what they're going to do? They're going to pressure them and pressure them and pressure them. Kansas State beats Texas that's down. They don't get up.
You know, it's almost become too obvious this week that Kansas State should blow out Texas. And if you're a Kansas State fan, you should be worried. Texas in the last 3 years has rebounded the week after losing to Oklahoma. I think Texas shows up angry today, ready to play. They're going to play much better than they did last week against Oklahoma. But it's a night game. Kansas State's defense will be ready. And also Darren Sproles, keep an eye on him, one of the best backs in the Big 12. And a play of the quarterback, L. Roberson. I like Kansas State to win, but they're going to have to fight their tails off because Texas will show up ready to go tonight.
They got that shotgun draw and Ron Hudson's game plan that Texas never stopped against Oklahoma.
Ron,
you guys both take K-State, huh?
Yeah. Oh, no, wait.
A good one.
You both take K-State?
Yes, yeah, we
should do.
I'm four in a row in the double not so fast. I'm going to pull the trigger. I'm going to go with Texas. Go with Texas. Try
good
to make
call.
It five straight over you guys. Good call.
I wish I was
good call.
I
all right. He called them both.
We'll
he made
good.
Nice
well,
Texas.
Let's make it interesting. Notre Dame's defense wants to make things interesting for Chance Herridge tonight. We'll talk to them coming up. And things are plenty interesting in the Big Ten. Maurice Claret talking, Joe Paterno talking. We'll talk all about that coming up on College Game Day from Colorado Springs. Oh, so folks in our crew got a chance to sample life as a cadet. No, just kidding. That is the Wings of Blue parachute team. Kirk wanted to join them.
Yep.
They didn't have an extra chute.
Yeah, right.
Speaking of blue, Big Blue Michigan and Purdue coming up at noon Eastern time. The Boilermakers almost have to have this one to keep their bowl hopes alive. They play well, but then they have a little trouble closing the deal. Mark Jones and Bob Davey have a preview from West Lafayette.
Well, the time for talking, jawjacking has stopped. It's time to play number 9 Michigan against Purdue, the 50th meeting between these two teams. And at the start of the year, John Navarre was challenged by his coach to be more of a playmaker, Bob Davey. He has been all that.
Mark, Michigan is a great place to be a college quarterback. But because of the expectations, it can also be a difficult place. Like all Michigan quarterbacks, John Navarre has seen both sides. But the last couple of weeks, it's been all good because Michigan has won three straight.
Now, there's been a quarterbacking controversy unfolding at Purdue. Kyle Orton has been the starter, but he has been pulled the last 2 weeks in favor of Brandon Kirsch.
Brandon Kearse is completing 61% of his passes. But what the Purdue coaches love is that he can also beat you with his legs. He's averaging 7.5 yards every time he carries the ball. He's given Purdue a spark the last 2 weeks.
Michigan trying to snap a 2-game losing streak at Purdue. Both teams trying to drink from the cup of success. Back to you guys.
All right, Kirk, John Navarre, what do you think? Are the road struggles over for good, or do they reemerge today?
Oh, I think that's the big question today. We'll see how far John Navarre has really matured. The team he's going up today against in Purdue, the last four times they've lost games this year, it's by an average of only 5 points a game. They've outperformed their opponent every time they've lost a game. So this is a good Purdue team. Navarre will need to step up and play well. The last two games, he's been able to regain his confidence. To me, the thing that's hurt John Navarre is you look at the Michigan running game. They don't have a Bioc Batuka, a Tyrone Wheatley, even an A-Train, Anthony Thomas. Chris Perry's not provided that spark, so they don't have that threat. And I think it puts more pressure on the passing of Navarre. Michigan's going to win, but I think it's going to be by about a field goal. They're going to have to earn this one today.
Staying in the Big Ten, let's take a look at Iowa. Iowa has an extremely explosive offense, well-rounded, but the key to their football team is Brad Banks, their quarterback. When he throws the football, he is sensational. Now, Brad Banks throws the football deep. He likes to throw it into the corner. And one of the most important things about this, Iowa's had 19 scoring plays over 20 yards this year. Marked down, 4 more against Indiana. Iowa blasts Indiana today.
They are at the Big House next week, your Iowa team. The unbeaten facing an upset trap today, Ohio State against the wounded Badgers in Madison. Here's the rub. Wisconsin's become a bad home team, too. I can't get out of the exit. They are 2-7 in the last 9 Big Ten home games. Today we might learn if their problems are real serious, because they have not had big plays with the running game. They can't protect the passer. They can't prevent big plays. Other than that, they're doing great. Of course, today it all starts with stopping a 600-yard game from Maurice Clarett. Clarett has been one of the best freshmen all time. Only Marshall Faulk had more yards in his first 6 games of a freshman season. Now, he is still 2.5 years away from legally entering the draft. That hasn't stopped Maurice or his mother from investigating and contemplating a possible challenge to the NFL and the Players Association. There was a big ESPN, the magazine story on it. Clarett did not exactly try to defuse the whole situation, Kirk. And I'm just wondering what the Buckeye veterans make of this now.
I think that's going to be, we're going to find out throughout this game. If you are living in Columbus, you've been around the Big Ten area, the timing of this is an issue. It's become really more of a distraction than it's really a concrete problem for the Ohio State Buckeyes. If you talk to their players, they'll tell you, oh, it's no big deal. But I think their maturity is being tested. Here's a guy that's only played 6 college football games, and this big article comes out. So I think they're looking at that and thinking, what's going on? But when the ball goes up in the air, it's just about playing football, and he's the guy that gives them a chance to win. But the team they're going up against today, you think they're excited? They're in a must-win situation. This article comes out, they're going to play them hard.
You like Ohio State? Or?
Go ahead.
Okay, I'm going to give it to you in a second. Now, Clarett has every right in the world to challenge the NFL and try to go into it. But the timing, there's no excuse for it. Why? Because the Buckeyes are in a Big Ten rush hunt. They're in a championship run. What is that plane coming from?
I don't know.
All right, now, and also, if you watch out for this one thing, I think it's going to be a distraction. I think it's going to bother the Buckeyes. The Buckeyes don't play well at home anyhow. The game's in Madison. I'm going with a big upset.
Ooh.
Wisconsin upsets the undefeated Buckeyes.
I think that's a very good pick, although I disagree. I think it's going to be a war for Ohio State. I, despite the distractions, I think the fact that Wisconsin's lost 2 games and they're in a must-win situation, Barry Alvarez is very good at getting his team ready to go. Ohio State, they've been talking all year about Clarett. Forget about Clarett in this game. Their ability to throw, can they protect their quarterback, Craig Krenzel, and make plays with their passing game will tell you if Ohio State wins this game. I think it comes down to a Mike Nugent field goal late in the game, like Ohio State by a field goal. Very close.
Clarett today, he needs a 153 to get to 1,000 yards. That would tie the 7-game freshman record of Faulk and Emmitt Smith. You think he's aware of that? You think he wants 153? Yeah, I think
he'll
so.
Stay in there.
Another Wisconsin.
Another talked about topic in the Big Ten these days, bad officiating. A couple of overtime losses the last 3 weeks. Joe Paterno has blasted the officials, venturing where very few coaches ever go, questioning their objectivity.
There was some concerns about the assignment of the same crew this year that worked on Michigan game. There was some concerns about the fact that 3 of them live in Michigan. There was some concern that someone said to me they had met with Dick Hornick who was the guy I had some problems with Iowa, who lives in Ann Arbor. So I think those kinds of things, I think that's what they should be looking at. Not necessarily that anybody's incompetent or what, but this, you know, we're all human beings.
Not necessarily incompetent, but consciously or subconsciously where they live affecting calls. That's a pretty strong statement.
Very strong. I was a Big Ten football coach for 10 years, and our rule was you go through the commissioner's office, you don't blast the officials publicly. No one does it. Joe Paterno, Woody Hayes, Bo Schembechler, or Lee Corso. And second, he inferred that the fact that these guys lived in Michigan, that they were a little bit on the side for Michigan. Whoa. I don't like that. Well, I don't like that at all.
Maybe I'm naive to this whole thing, but in my opinion, look at this. These officials have climbed the ladder and worked their tails off to get into a position to finally be in a premier conference like the Big Ten. And I don't think subconsciously, oh, I'm from Michigan, I'm going to help the Wolverines. I think Joe Paterno was out of line there. It's really out of character for Joe Paterno, and I disagree with him.
Frustration of those overtime losses. By the way, tonight, officials, Big Ten.
Ooh.
We don't know if they're from Indiana or Colorado, where they're from, but they are Big Ten officials. A lot more coming up on College Game Day from the Air Force Academy. We'll visit with Seneca Wallace of Iowa State and a total breakdown of this battle of unbeaten as well. Of course, the Fighting Irish have been winning by any means necessary, and the defense has been doing more than its share, more than anybody could ask of them. All eight opponents' fumbles this year recovered by the Irish, a total of 19 takeaways. That's more than three a game, and all season, the defense has only allowed one touchdown in the first half. They are tough, they're tight, and they're creative enough to come up with a motivational tool that tonight targets Air Force's quarterback, and that we hope did not derive from lyrics to a Two Live Crew song. Shelley Smith on the defenders of the Irish perfect record.
One, two, three, four. The Notre Dame defensive mentality has bred a certain fierce expectation within Irish walls. So fierce that a practice discipline, push-ups for dropped balls, has spilled over onto the playing field during games.
Again, the push-ups.
That's been instilled in my head, so in the game, I mean, guys are just doing push-ups. I mean, like, we're out in the practice field.
We usually do 10, but if you just got to get 5, you know, you do a few push-ups and you get back and get ready to go to the next play.
It's something that I don't think they will be a part of again, simply because I think they recognize the competitive spirit and the sportsmanship that our program and themselves would like to demonstrate.
These guys are so competitive that they've even invented their own little game within the game, something the coaching staff doesn't even know about. It's called the Buck List, and it's not a list that anybody wants to be on.
The Buck List.
Tell me about that, Shane?
It's when you get hit, when you initiate the hit, but you're the one going back. They lower their shoulder and we lower our shoulder, but they end up on the ground and we don't. So whoever's on their back, they're considered on the Buck List.
The Buck List starts in practice, and players on both sides of the ball are aware of it.
We have competitions every Tuesday and Wednesday when we're on full pass, and the thing is not to get on the Buck List.
So who's been on the Buck List the most?
Ooh, I can't tell you that. They'll get a little upset with me. I can't tell you. Just put all the running backs are just about on the Buck List.
I think that would be a statement from Colonel Schultz of Hogan's Heroes, okay? I know nothing.
Is that because you don't want to know anything?
Well, being that you're asking me that question, it probably implies that I should not know.
I don't think that's really something that, you know, the coaches would smile upon. You know, that's kind of a... it's kind of like the darker side of, of our defense.
Do you ever pick out guys on the opposing team and say, all right, he's on the Buck List?
Oh, yeah. Michigan State, Charles Rogers was definitely on the Buck List. Braylon Edwards from Michigan, he was on there. We got some good shots on him, too.
There's been a lot of games. The Glenn Earl done put a few guys on the Buck List.
The competition this week is to see who can be the first to put Air Force quarterback Chance Herridge on the Buck List.
He's our biggest Bucky, if you will.
He wants to carry the ball, he's gonna get hit. I'm sure he'll welcome the challenge. So we'll be sure to, you know, welcome into our club.
Mike Golic joins us now. Of course, played for the Fighting Irish from 81 to 84. He'll be calling the game tonight for ESPN. You played against Air Force three times.
Yeah.
What are your memories from this great great team?
This is a good memory because I actually showed
there
a little bit of quickness making the tackle. Now, this next one, understand,
come on, 5-5. Where
I had,
are you?
I had
come
a bad
on.
Leg.
Oh,
I tripped.
Head plant.
I tell you what, they make you get out of your game plan a little bit there. You know, I should have stayed on the pitch, man. I went to the quarterback. That's what happened.
First play looked good. You're okay. That's tonight against this triple option attack. Defensively, what's the key for Notre Dame trying to stop Chance Herridge?
First, don't do what I did on that second play, but you have to be disciplined in how you prepare for this option offense. Now, what you have to do is if you have the quarterback and Chance Herridge is the man you have to stop here, you want to bait him and you stop him right there. Don't let him cut back to the inside. Take away that lane and make him pitch it late enough to where your rotation can come around on the defense and your extra man can come up and he's got to take it from the outside, force the running back inside so if he doesn't make the tackle, his friends are coming. So that's the way you have to do it. Now they're going to switch up as well the defenses. It's not going to be like that, the load option. They're going to be blocking as well. That way you just have to get off the blocks as well. But you've got to be able to keep Chance Harris from cutting it up and making pitches.
And then you got to worry about the play action off of the option. Mentally, how tough is it for Notre Dame, a perennial power, to get ready for the academies? What's the biggest challenge in that area?
Biggest challenge is that, is you know it's 60 minutes of football from the Air Force. What they do in the first quarter, they do in the fourth quarter. They frustrate you mentally. You think you're bigger, stronger, and faster. You should be able to stop them because they're smaller than you, and you find yourself in the third quarter, they're still getting up 10 yards a carry because they're in your legs and you can't get off and make the play.
This is going to be a great game. Appreciate it, buddy.
Right,
appreciate
man, no
it. Let's go back to Chris.
Kirk, did we get Mike's record against Air Force? Said 0-3.
Leave it to Fowler to stick you, all right?
Jerry Faust here, they lost 4 in a row, which is not good. Next, Seneca Wallace, creator of the most exciting 12-yard run in history.
There's Wallace pumping, looking, running to his right, looking, and he's going to be almost caught. Now he's running at the 25 and runs down the sideline, back to the 10. Now he's giving ground, goes around to the 10 to the left.
Well, still ahead, plenty more in this battle of unbeatens and, of course, Air Force Notre Dame predictions. By now, many of you know the story of Seneca Wallace, recruited by Oregon State as a DB, back to Sacramento City College, pressed into quarterback duty, and then Iowa State, perhaps the only major program that wanted him as a quarterback, grabs him. Now, Wallace is scintillating enough to turn a 3-3 snooze fest into something worth watching, but he's also smart, and he has the leadership. So, friends, Romans, Cyclones, gather as Jeremy Schapp presents the wisdom of Seneca.
It is a rough road that leads to the heights of greatness.
It's probably only a coincidence that the deeds of Seneca Wallace bring to mind the words of his namesake, the ancient Roman philosopher Seneca.
There is no great genius without some touch of madness.
Wallace under center, back to throw.
Pumping, looking, running to his right.
Getting chased.
Almost caught.
But now he's starting to go upfield to 25 to 20.
Back to the 10.
Cuts to the center of the field. A huge block at the 10-yard line.
And to the left side to the 5.
And Wallace will go in to score.
Oh, my goodness, what a run by Wallace.
Nothing demonstrated the genius of this Seneca so well as his mad, winding dash to the end zone against Texas Tech.
Play was Trey Wright, Liz Gator, and once I seen that, you know, my receiver fell down and my second receiver fell down, I was just trying to get out, either throw the ball away or, you know, get out of bounds.
And I saw him coming towards me, so I just kind of last second threw a block and he cut off that.
But once I got past that last defender, I knew that I probably can, you know, get upfield and make some things happen.
But he seemed to make, you know, all 11 guys miss twice.
You know, once I hit that sideline and cut back and got some good blocks from my running back and tied in, next thing I know, I was, you know, walking into the end zone with my receiver.
The guy runs over 100 yards for a 12-yard touchdown. Doesn't even seem like he's even hardly out of breath. He's amazing.
That was just the way you planned it, right?
Just the way we worked on it. We practiced it that way. Thursday and Friday, we practiced it that way.
What fools these mortals be.
With his dancer's feet and gymnastic agility, Wallace can make even the most talented defenders seem leaden.
that's what he makes it look like sometimes. And he can take over a game, and he makes people look pretty silly sometimes.
You can tell the character of every man when you see how he receives praise.
The thing about Seneca is there's no other player in the nation that has more value towards his team. You know, you take Seneca Wallace away from us, we're an average team.
The play, as it's now known, exemplifies everything that is Seneca Wallace.
Well, that just describes just how I am. You know, I'm a competitor, and I'm not gonna let up on anything. You know, when things go bad, you gotta improvise and try to make something good happen out of it. And, you know, that's what I try to do.
Or as the other Seneca might have put it, what fools these defenders be.
What fools put together this Iowa State schedule? Well, the computers did, but you gotta have human intervention. I mean, that's outrageous that they are made to play that schedule. Wallace is the Heisman frontrunner, Kirk, in all of those straw polls. He's going to have to be to get through that kind of a schedule starting today.
You're right about that. That is not fair for anybody in that conference. Iowa State's offense has scored at least 30 points in 7 straight games. Will that continue today against his stiffest challenge, the Oklahoma defense? If it does, Wallace will obviously be the key. And I'm telling you right now, his play has the attention of this Oklahoma defense. Talking to Mike Stoops this week, they're emphasizing containing Wallace here against Iowa. It's really a coverage sack. Good coverage downfield, allowing the pressure to get to him. This time they're going to chase him down from the backside, and it's about getting pressure on Seneca Wallace, and that's the big key today. Two things that Oklahoma has to do: get pressure on him, contain him, and when he does improvise and create, the Oklahoma secondary has to stay with the Iowa State wide receivers, because that's where Wallace can really hurt you. Hard-fought game. Oklahoma wins, but I think Wallace is going to make some plays, but the OU defense creates enough turnovers to win the game.
Good pick. Good analysis. Now, when you talk about Seneca Wallace and Iowa State, you always talk about their offense. Ah, not so fast, my friends. Iowa State's defense has tremendously improved over the years. When you look at those numbers, watch the way they keep getting better and better on defense. But here's the top one. In 1997, Iowa State was 110th in the nation on defense. Today, they're number 7. That is amazing. Now, as Kirk said, they'll play wonderfully. But old Kirk's team, and now my new team, Oklahoma, will win somehow in the fourth quarter.
Now your new team? Well, after 8 times.
What do you think, though?
After 8 times.
Heisman chances for Wallace. He can withstand a loss in that brutal stretch, but not too many.
Because of that schedule, he can lose today and win those others. He can still win the Heisman.
But a tough, tough road ahead. He's going to have to be the best player in the country to get his team through that group. We'll focus down on Air Force and Notre Dame as we continue to meet the sophomore captain of the Falcons coming up from Colorado Springs.
On Campus is presented by Outback, proud sponsor of the 2003 Outback Bowl.
You know, Air Force was 6-6 last year, so Fisher DeBerry went searching for leaders. For the first time ever, the Falcon players elected captains, and they elected a sophomore middle linebacker at a place where class hierarchy is very, very important. But then again, Anthony Schlegel is not just another sophomore.
Some of the better officers are not always the spit and polish type of guys.
In the backfield, it was Anthony Schlegel.
He represents the academy in his own way.
Intercepted by the Falcons, Anthony Schlegel.
He's a nice guy. When he steps on the field, he's an animal, 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 animal.
He is Anthony Schlegel, the fiery force of the Air Force defense, with an intense style adopted from his role model and obsession, the immortal number 51.
I just discovered Dick Butkus, and ever since then, it was all I want to do is be a linebacker.
Here's a guy that's a hard hat, blue collar, you know, bring your lunch pail type of guy that just say he's old school. You know, he's black high top shoes, no face mask type of guy. You could just picture him being there.
I remember one time they were showing him how he was on the sidelines. He was holding his hands, and like his hands were just completely bloody, you know, and he just had this stare in his eye that, you know, he was just ready to go out there and hit somebody.
We'll play video games and he'll make a play, you know, Dick Butkus, and put like the little thin bar on his face mask, you know, and he loves that stuff. You know, he loves, you know, his old school football, you know, hitting people in the mouth. And I think that's why I like Dick Butkus so much.
So much so that he carries his most prized possessions, a personalized autograph from Butkus and a laminated playing card of the legend wherever he goes.
This was given to me by a colonel, and who knew I love Dick Butkus, and, you know, I just think it's awesome because he's standing there against Green Bay, you know, and you see the stare in his eye.
This monster of the Midwest has animal instincts off the field as well. During the offseason, the 6'2", 245-pound linebacker chases down 300-pound wild boar.
We take dogs and knives and go out East Texas and go find hogs and kill them.
I want to set the record straight. This whole boar hunting ordeal, I mean, he's gone boar hunting, but, I mean, it's not...
You're not buying it?
It's not, no. He doesn't chase down boars and jump on their back and kill them with a knife, you know. You know, he takes dogs with him, and it's a little more or less savage than he makes it out to be.
Nonetheless, Schlegel's mission is the same, whether hunting wild boar or wild running back.
It's a lot of the same thing, just, you know, get to stab the wild boar, but...
You sound like you're sad you can't stab a running back.
No, you know, I don't want to stab a running back, but, you know, it's a good time, and it's definitely a rush. I think definitely tackling a ball carrier, though, is a far greater rush than killing a wild boar.
He's a piece of work. They got 7 or 8 Texans on that defensive 2-deep. Kirk, when you watch him, it seems like almost every play, there's a guy coming free unblocked. How are they doing that?
Well, it's amazing to think this is the same defense that we saw Air Force with a lot of the talent from last year. Think about that. They went in the offseason, they visited South Carolina and Charlie Strong, and they implemented the 3-3-5. And what they like to do is there's a lot of movement, a lot of confusion. They're constantly getting up to the line of scrimmage and forcing teams to have to throw, and that's what Carlisle Holiday will face tonight. They're going to get up into the face of Carlisle Holiday and Notre Dame's running game and see if they can take that aspect away from Notre Dame and make Holiday throw tonight to move the ball.
Now, on the other side of the ball, Air Force offense is a perfect example of a wonderful ball control football team. They are number 2 in the nation in time of possession. That means the Irish will not get the ball much, so they better do something with it right away, and Carlisle Holiday is the key to the Irish offensive football team. Now, watch Holiday, number 7, as he hits a fade route in the left-hand corner to Arnez Battles. It's a sensational catch. Now, this game will be a tremendous battle, a pressure battle of strong-willed, excellent character football teams. And the first team that blinks loses.
Neither team has blinked so far. Neither team has beaten themselves. Time of possession, by the way, is normally a really overrated stat. You think it's actually important tonight. You
guys,
whoever has the ball is big.
Absolutely.
All right, we will come back. We'll recap the big games of the day as far as these guys' predictions. And then, of course, that's time for headgear. Fighting Irish or Falcons? These folks are waiting to find out.
On Campus is presented by Outback, proud sponsor of the 2003 Outback Bowl. Today's show, presented by Discover Card. Want to appear on Gameday this New Year's Day? Visit discovercard.com for details. And in part by MLB Authentic Collection, apparel for on the field or in the stands.
C-17 there. Let's recap the big games. Ohio State and Wisconsin, Lee.
The Buckeyes are below average road team. I'm taking Wisconsin in an upset.
Upset, I think Prenzel throws the Buckeyes to a victory.
Washington at USC.
USC outscores Washington with the pass.
Opposite. I think Cody Pickett with the pass outscores Carson Palmer. 2-for-2 here.
I love the disagreement. Right. Iowa State at Oklahoma.
My new team, Oklahoma, finds a way to win.
Too late. Forget about it. Oklahoma's defense actually plays well against Seneca Wallace, creating turnovers to win.
Now to the battle of unbeaten tonight. Kirk, whose dream season? Who's